deep, very serious.
Okay, good day everyone. Good day everyone and welcome to the final panel of the third day conference of the Israeli Association for Japanese Studies. My name is Nisim Otmazgin and I'm the chair of the Asian Studies Department here at Hebrew University of Jerusalem. I was the previous chair of the Israeli Association for Japanese Studies. I personally work on Japanese modern history, politics, and culture. And I'm very happy to be the chair of this final session. And today we have three presentations given by four presenters. The title of this panel is Animation and Popular Culture in the Heisei Area. Just a few words about popular culture, contemporary culture in Japan and in Israel. I can tell you as a person who's teaching about Japan here in Jerusalem, these days, contemporary Japanese culture is what brings students into class, much more than Japanese history, managerial system, or the economy as it used to be in the 80s. So here at the Department of Asian Studies, at least here, and I know in other universities as well, so a big majority of our students, they enter the field of Japanese studies, they want to learn about Japan through this gateway of contemporary culture, of Japanese culture, especially popular culture. But once they come in, we make them study history and politics and society and of course language. Language is extremely important. But we offer a few elective courses on contemporary culture, such as the one of Dr. Kameda Madar and Dr. Raz Greenberg, who is also one of the speakers here. So it is extremely important. Let me also mention, for those of you who don't know, that at the library, at the Central Library here at the Hebrew University, we have a whole room dedicated to manga in Japanese. So we have a few almost thousands, of books, mostly in Japanese, manga books. And the library has allocated a special area for us and it is open for everyone. It's on the fourth floor, so if you haven't seen it yet, please, you are more than welcome to go to see it. So without further ado, I suggest that we'll start the presentation. Let me introduce each of the speakers, followed by approximately up to 20 minutes talk by each person. And then finally, we'll open the floor for discussions and questions. So the first speaker of the panel is Dr. Kazuko Kameda Madar. She's a lecturer at Hawaii Pacific University and the University of Hawaii at Manoa in Honolulu. She's also a visiting researcher at Ritsumeikan University in Kyoto. Kameda Madar is the co-editor of an anthology, Utsukushi no Chikara, Power of Utsukushi, Matrix of Creation and Continuity from Kyoto, Shinbunkaku Press in 2014. Her publications include few other papers in early modern Japan and Terrorizing Imitation in a Global Context. I should also add that Dr. Kameda Madar, she's a special friend of the Israeli Association of Japanese Studies, and she has visited Israel several times, both giving talks on issues related to Japanese art, as well as special seminars. Last year, she gave a seminar on reading Kokuji, and this time she's at the Hebrew University, helping us analyze and document a new donation that we received of Japanese art. We have approximately 44 scrolls of Japanese from the 15th until the 19th century. We have hundreds of ukiyo-e and a few other items which we received as a donation, but we don't know about them so much. So with the help of Dr. Kameda Madar, we are able now to analyze them and to prepare them, and later on, I hope, hopefully at the end of this year, we'll digitalize them and put them all on the website so researchers can approach them. So Dr. Kameda Mada, onegai shimasu.
Thank you very much for kind introduction, Professor Nishim. And I must say, like, you know, it's a very same phenomenon happening in Hawaii also. Popular culture is the one, you know, brings students in Hawaii also. So I'm not actually specialist of contemporary culture. Actually, I specialize in pre-modern Edo period paintings, you know, in Japan. But somehow, because of the heavy demand of the students, I began to teach manga and anime courses a couple years already. But anyways, today I like to use the your name blockbuster anime film your name as an example to analyze religio-cultural and also social significance of the Japan in the very much, you know, at the end of the Heisei period. Okay. But your name is, you know, some of you might know, written and directed by Shinkai Makoto, who is actually very young director, you know, that matters. You know, he's born in 1973. And you know, this film was premiered at the Anime Expo of 2016 in Los Angeles. And shortly after, it was premiered in Japan on August 27th. But anyway, since then, it became highest grossing anime film according to Box Office Mojo. It's surpassing the Spirited Away, famous Spirited Away, directed by Miyazaki Hayao, coming from Studio Ghibli. Most of the, you know, anime films other than Pokemon and Doraemon coming from the Studio Ghibli, but it's, you know, Your Name by Shinkai Makoto is completely different from the nature of the Ghibli production. And I'm keep pushing this. Okay, but I like to, you know, through this presentation, I like to kind of like, you know, analyze the Your Name film, Your Name as an indication of the current time period, Heisei period is coming to the end. Now I'm kind of talking about a little bit of a Heian period too, but anyways, how Shinkai Makoto appropriates classical literature or classical culture at the end of a Heisei era. And also, you know, this film includes the urban rural issues and gender hierarchy, experiences of catastrophic natural disasters, of course, I think related to that, religiosity and spirituality is very important factors, you know, of this film. And the targeted audience actually shows the time period, how this film is actually, you know, I like to conclude, you know, at the end, how audiences of the this film, you know, in the beginning especially, kind of shows the targeted to the lost generation. We call it lost gene. Those are who, you know, grew up after the, you know, bubble economy, you know, after burst of the, you know, economy, they are kind of like, you know, giving up everything and stuff like that. But anyways, also, I like to talk about the Yutori generation and Satori generation briefly at the end of the, you know, presentation in relation to this film. Okay, but anyways, no, okay, sorry, you know, if you haven't watched it, you know, I will spoil this, you know, story. But even you know the storyline, it's a good film. I went to see this film 5 times in the theater and I cried 5 times. So anyways, so, you know, it starts from the, you know, two high schoolers, you know, teenagers, 17 years old to 17 years old, a city boy, Taki, and country girl, Mitsuha. They start switching bodies in their dreams. So they never never met, no, in no actual sense, but somehow, no, by switching, no, each other's, no, body and environment and lifestyle, no, somehow, like, no, they really kind of like started to fall in love to each other. But anyways, swapping bodies and swapping genders is not, you know, new idea in Japan. Even the director Shinkai wanted to use the, you know, this preliminary title, Ime to Shiriseba, Danjo Torikaebae Monogatari. If kind of something like a rough, you know, translation is, if I knew if it is a dream, the change them. This is a Torikaebae Monogatari, is authored by the anonymous, you know, probably female author, you know, in the Heian period, 12th century, actually, you know, it's very much, you know, the borderline, because come going to the Kamakura period, but anyways, depicting the, you know, a story of Heian courtly life. You know, how boyish girl and how, you know, girlish boy, you know, they switch their lives and, you know, all kind of dramas, you know, leading after. And, you know, this story is very popular in many generations. And, you know, latest adaptation is, you know, this actually manga adaptation by the Saito Chiho came out in 2015. And you know, all those are kind of like, you know, in the mind of Shinkai. But anyways, another inspiration might be in the, you know, your name is Utatane Zoshi. Utatane Zoshi is actually emaki produced in the 15th century Muromachi period. So, you know, in this story, only in their dream, like, you know, couples, you know, two, like, boy and girl, you know, they can meet, you know, each other. So, you know, they try to sleep. They try to make a nap. You know, they can see each other in the reality, but only in the dream. So, you know, this kind of, like, a story is very much, you know, deeply rooted in the Japanese classical culture. And, okay, of course, waka, Japanese poetry, is very important. And, okay, poems or examples composed by Onono Komachi in the 9th century. It's also, again, you know, rough translation. Dreamt of him whom I am in love with. If I knew it was a dream, I would have not woken up forever. It's kind of like a, you know, this kind of like a, you know, similar tone of story. Couple only, you know, they can meet, you know, during, you know, in their dream. Is really like a part of Japanese culture, but, you know, in your name, I mean, it is kind of like appropriated and reinterpreted in the, you know, Heian context. But anyways, you know, even, you know, one of the poems coming from Manyoshu, Shinkai actually uses it to address the one of the most important key point, Tasogare Twilight. Because in the twilight, this, you know, Taki and Mitsuha, you know, 2 17s can actually meet, you know, kind of like a magical hour. And magical hour is actually, you know, believed in Japanese culture for many generations also, but it's leading to the Manyoshu poem of the very classical tradition also. So who is that? Like, you know, in that, you know, who is that? Kind of like, you know, asking this question and, you know, meaning of twilight, you know, like a time between the sundown till nightfall is very important in this film later. But anyways, this teacher of the classical literature for Mitsuha's school is actually coming from the protagonist of the another film, beautiful film, directed by Shinkai, The Garden of the Worlds. And you know, she is a, Yuki-chan sensei is a protagonist from this film. So it's not only, you know, she is, again, another teacher who kind of like, she's actually classical literature teacher. So, you know, she addresses like, you know, Heian and more actually, you know, Nara literature also. But what's important is Shinkai uses actual places in Tokyo and beautifies it. So, you know, it's like a space is very important. Current Tokyo, 2016, 2013, in this case, actual place, she uses it, you know, which is a Shinjuku Gyoen Park in Tokyo. And, you know, so as in your name, he uses many actual place located in Tokyo, 2016. Anyways, you know, this is one of the example depicting the, you know, Shinjuku area. And, you know, it's really really Tokyo Meta Policy is depicted so beautifully because this is supposed to be seen from the one of the protagonists, Mitsuha, who is living in the countryside, but she can tire of it because somehow she feels like an inferiority of the, you know, lifestyle there. Can be, you know, bias, but somehow she aspires to be in Tokyo, and, you know, suddenly she's sitting in the, you know, Tokyo boy, and from her eyes, through her eyes, Tokyo, the scenes of the Tokyo is, you know, seen very beautifully. You know, you can see the, you know, Docomo Tower and all kinds of like landmarks, you know, many of you can recognize. So, you know, it's a strong sense of Tokyo centralism. Hierarchical relationship between Tokyo urban male and Itomori rural female. So it's like a high, kind of like a, you know, gender hierarchy is also kind of showing the urban rural relationship too. So in the time of the disaster and then, like, you know, the past 2 days, you know, today also, we have been kind of like discussing about the disaster, say, you know, time of, you know, all kinds of things. But, you know, rural area, oftentimes, you know, they have to wait until Tokyo makes decisions. And so somehow, like, economic, of course, the, you know, benefit is not divided, you know, equal, fairly. But anyways, all kinds of things are depicted in the 2016 setting. But anyways, but still, like, this, like, actually, Itomori Town, you know, where Mitsuha lives is fictional. It doesn't exist. But this town is somehow located somewhere in the, supposed to be located somewhere in the Mount Hida in Gifu Prefecture. And it's actually, you know, depicted very beautifully also. It's also very beautifully depicted. It's not inferior. The depiction is very beautiful. And Itomori means actually thread guard. And later it becomes very important because kumihimo making is very much like an important key for, you know, this film. But anyways, another interesting thing is pilgrimage. No, okay, we're talking about pilgrimage for the, like, most, like, you know, desirable place of the pilgrimage of the, you know, world. But in Japan, pilgrimage is not for the sacred place, but, you know, anime places. So fans, they are looking for the, you know, they almost for them, it's a sacred place, like, you know, going up to the Yerushalayim, they're looking for the places depicted in the anime. But by the way, it's interesting thing is this is supposed to be seen through the eyes of Tokyo boy Taki in the body of Mitsuha. And especially, you know, something like this, it's gorgeously depicted. So Shinkai doesn't think probably, you know, inferiority of the rural area. And Shinkai himself actually coming from the Nagano prefecture, he only went up to Tokyo for the college, for the university. But anyway, while, you know, Taki and Mitsuha communicating through the cell phones, because they can never see each other, they only see each other in the dream while, you know, switching, and they began to communicate through, you know, cell phone. And, you know, somehow, you know, picture shows how their times has a, you know, 3 year gap between between their times. Mitsuha's cell phone, you know, is, if you pay attention, Mitsuha's cell phone is iPhone 5. So, you know, it's actively circulated in 2013. And, you know, Taki's iPhone is iPhone 6. No, it's updated, you know, 2016. And no, it's very much like, you know, small like, you know, details are, you know, very carefully crafted. And while, of course, you know, they are kind of communicating, they fall in love, but one day they stopped switching. And somehow, you know, he kind of eagerly looks for Mitsuha using the text, using the phone, but somehow, you know, he can communicate with her. This is a scene. He is looking for Mitsuha unsuccessfully, but he doesn't give up. And probably previous protagonists of Shinkai, you know, they give up. I will explain about why, you know, Satori and Yutori generations, but Daki is actually doesn't fall to the Losgene Satori Yutori generation. He is man who is wanting something. So he doesn't give up not being able to communicate with her. So he steps out of his hometown, Tokyo, and go to look for her physically. And finding out the comet struck on the town of the Itamori 3 years ago, and Mitsuha was already dead three years ago. Okay. I tried to cut all 1995 Great Hanshin earthquake also. So Kumamoto earthquake also, disastrous, it happened 2016. Of course, we are located on the fire of Ring of Fire. We have a kind of disaster, but anyways, I'm not gonna discuss about this because yesterday and the day before yesterday, we were very much informed by the wonderful presentations of about the those incidents. But anyways, Taki doesn't give up after hearing the Mitsuha passed away. He still tries to communicate with him, so he doesn't give up. This is very important at the end of Heisei era, because middle of Heisei era, people give up, people don't want much, but this is a new protagonist, and he uses this Kuchika Misake. But anyways, religiosity and spirituality are somehow interpreted interestingly, and the Kuchika Misake is a type of alias sake, a rice-based alcohol produced by process involving human saliva as a fermentation starter, and this is actually advertisement. Mitsuha and her little sister Yotsuha tries to promote, to kind of commercialize this sake, and actually in reality, sake brewers in the Hida, they are commercializing those sake. Of course, those sake are brewed like a normal way, not by mouse, but still it's like a 3,000 yen, it's like affordable price, and they are commercializing, and it's limited edition, but this is a Watanabe Shizouten. But anyways, it's very much like a interesting phenomenon, probably kind of like helping to revitalize the rural area, in actual sense also. And before that, actually I cut, it's beautiful, scene for the purification dance. But anyways, Mitsuha is a high school girl, but her real identity is a Miko priestess, of her own home shrine, and before producing the Kuchika Misake, she performs the purification dance together with her little sister, and this is very much like a reminiscent of real purification ritual performed here and there in the shrine, and this kind of bell is purification ritual bell, suzuharai, and this also coming from the classical source. This is actually one of the image coming from Nenju Gyoji Emaki. So although original was lost, but supposed to be attributed to Tokiwa Mitsunaga, painted in the 12th century. So actually this kind of ritual using the bell to purify the environment was very much adapted in the new setting. And Mitsuha, her name is other than being Miko priestess, Miyamizu shrine. Actually, her home shrine is a shrine of water, the transportation is. But anyways, Mitsuha's name also has a multi-layer of the meaning. Mitsuha itself is three leaves, but also referring to in deeper meaning, that's a pishat. Deeper meaning is Mitsuhame no kami, spirit of rushing water, can appear in the Nihon Shoki or Kojiki, and all kind of like older text. And the Taki is Taki's name is waterfall. So some kind of like water as a kind of like a connection to kind of like a hold a story. But anyway, there were three years time difference gap between Taki and Mitsuha in real time. So Taki didn't remember her when Mitsuha have visited Turkey. But okay, important point is, again, so as Turkey stepping out his hometown, and Mita also steps out her hometown and you know, going to look for him. So it's like, you know, they're both kind of like positive figures kind of stepping out, you know, their own environment. But anyway, here, Kumihimo and Kurashika were kind of like a note, and also religious kind of like a meaning. But anyways, okay, here, okay, I try to do fast. She dies once, right? So, you know, this is, okay, gaming reality is, you know, depicted. Actually, you know, she dies once. You know, this is called bad end. And no, but you know, he goes to rescue her and they meet. So no, this is a true end. So this kind of like, okay, so this is a kind of timeline. So you know, Mitsuha and Taki kind of started to swap, you know, when they were 17 years old, but there was actually 3 years gap because of the, you know, Kumihimo, they kind of going back and forth and like, you know, kind of intricated way. Somehow at the end, kind of, you know, they can meet each other finally in the real time. So, you know, Mitsuha was 26 and Taki is 23 at the end of the story. But anyways, you know, this kind of like gaming is very much like a, you know, background of Shinkai Makoto. He was actually coming from, you know, his career was associated with making the erotic games, you know, for a long time. So, you know, they call it, you know, galge or eroge, erotic games. And, you know, somehow, you know, that this whole, like, your name's, like, you know, plot is based on the, his previous, you know, career of making the erotic game. So, unlike Miyazaki Hayao or, you know, Oshimamoru or, you know, those, you know, who are producing the family, you know, film, he doesn't afraid of kind of like including the, you know, erotic scenes, because that's, you know, his actual background. And also, okay, I'm really looking forward for the, on the, you know, Raz Sensei's presentation, so I'm not gonna talk much about the voice of Star, Distant Star, but no, this is actually example of the Sekai-kei anime. And Sekai-kei anime, okay, it's the time, okay. Okay, so Sekai-kei anime starts with very normal, regular life. Then, like, a central character becomes aware of profound danger to the world at large. And the boy meets girl who is also aware of incoming, apocalyptic spirits and, may strive to prevent it. But anyways, you know, not so much of the, you know, situation is being described, but at the end, most of the stories end up being the kind of like a sweet, bitter end. You know, they can be together, but you know, audiences are okay because those are targeted to the Lost Gen and Yutori and Satori generations. And, no, okay. Anyways, no, Sekai-kei always involve beautiful fighting heroine images. So who are the consumers of, you know, those images? Okay, number one, narcissistic pre-puberty young girls, and also mature women seeking empowering fantasy. And also, but best, you know, most of the biggest consumer is male otaku. And okay, so otaku is okay outside. Okay, okay, we have to finish. Yeah, okay. Right. Okay, so it's very different from the okay U.S. like, you know, female, it's masculine women, or you know, it's very different kind of like, you know, type. But of course, you know, we have a like, you know, beautiful fighting girl genre made, you know, for a long time. Okay, just to flash it. So Mitsuha is certainly healing Miko type. You know, I have five different images, but anyways, genre types, but Maho Shoujo type, Takarazuka Theater type, Transformation type, and Robot Combating type. Right, so no, but anyway, Ayana Miley from the, you know, the Evangelion is a best selling image of the, you know, beautiful fighting girl. And okay, so those figures are quite expensive, you know, $45,000 almost. But you know, usually male otaku buy three. One, you know, they don't open the box, you know, for the collection. Number second, you know, they trade. And number three, they use for masturbation. Because, okay, so those like generation, okay, I will summarize, you know, I'm not gonna explain, but anyways, you know, those generation, they don't want, but also they are afraid of having the actual relationship with female. So, you know, they are having those images, and, you know, that this is what are happening in the Satori generation and Yutori generation, right? But anyways, so Shinkai's, you know, earlier work, you know, okay, this is almost a conclusion. Anyways, so this is, okay, Shinkai, somehow, you know, his targeted audiences, you know, they were okay with the earlier work, like a couple, you know, they, it's a, like a, you know, sweet bitter end, you know, they can be together, and but somehow Taki steps out, and you know, at the end, like, you know, he get together with, you know, two protagonists get together. So okay, so this is the last slide. So okay, it's after post Yutori and Lost Yutori and Satori generations, you know, it's like a new beginning at the end of Heisei period. This is a new beginning, I think. And I'm hoping, you know, Japan will kind of like hit the bottom and come right back.
It looked like you had a lot more to say, and it was an interesting to hear an art historian's take on popular culture and anime, and I appreciate this effort, and I think you gave us some interesting ideas which we may revisit in the discussion later on. But allow me to invite Dr. Raz Greenberg. Raz Greenberg is a comics and animation scholar who received his PhD on animation as a text from the Hebrew University of Jerusalem, with early Japanese animation as one of his major case studies. His published research includes essays on childhood in the films of Hayao Miyazaki and Jewish influence on the work of Japan's god of comics, Osamu Tezuka Osamu. His current research focuses on the sources of influence for Japanese animation, including the animated film of brothers Max and David Fleischer, modern puppetry and traditional representations of female characters in Japanese culture. He teaches classes about Japanese comics and animations, both here at the Hebrew University and at Tel Aviv University. Raz Greenberg, お願いします.
Thank you, Nissim. I'm very glad for the opportunity to speak right after Dr. Kameda Madar here, since in this presentation I will also be talking toward the end of the presentation about a film by director Makoto Shinkai, one of his earlier films, Hoshi no Koe, or Voices of a Distant Star, as it is known in English. And I will be speaking about this film in the context of what I call the Heisei era as a post-otaku era. To understand what exactly I mean by post-otaku, or for that matter otaku, we need to go back to the Showa era, a time when, among many, many other things, animation became one of Japan's leading cultural products. It was a gradual process. The Showa era began with the move of Japanese animation from the domain of independent animators who worked in their homes to professional studios. It continued with ambitious projects, as Japan's first feature-length animated film, produced during World War II. It saw the rise of Japanese television animated productions in the post-war period. And in the concluding decade of the Showa era, we also saw the beginning of the very successful collaboration, which goes on to this very day, between Japan's video game and animation industries. It was in the same decade that we also saw the rise of the otaku. The nickname otaku was given to fans of Japanese animated productions, mostly of science fiction animated productions, usually of the most commercial, and I would even use the word trashy, nature. And these fans studied these productions obsessively to their smallest detail. They collected everything that had something to do with these productions, all forms of merchandise. And slowly, the animation industry began to recognize the otaku and directly address them. With the most fascinating example, in my opinion, being the Daikon opening films. Daikon is the name of Japan's annual science fiction convention when it is held in the city of Osaka. And in the third Daikon convention held in 1981, a group of fans surprised the convention's guests when it premiered a short film that they produced completely without the help of a studio. They did it, it was a 100% independent film, which was a loving homage to all the tropes of the science fiction productions that the group, later known as Otaku, admired. The film met with enthusiastic reaction from the convention's guests, and the people who made it, then known as Daikon Film, went on, armed with a bigger budget, to produce another film for the following Daikon convention in 1983. This was a far more polished production, although, again, made independently without the help of a studio. In this sense, it was a very innovative film because Japanese independent animation existed long before that, alongside commercial animation, but it was mostly the Japanese independent animation before the Daikon films was mostly of abstract and art house nature. The Daikon films were embracing the different tropes of commercial Japanese animation and playing them you could say, in full volume. I would like to show a few minutes of the second Daikon, of the Daikon 4 opening animation film.
Just on the border of your waking mind, there lies another time, where darkness and light are one. And as you tread the halls of sanity, you feel so glad to be unable to go beyond. I have a message on another time.
You leave me here and then you go on.
This film, which again I will remind you, was produced without the help of the of a studio. It was produced independently. This film celebrates the different tropes of the most commercial science fiction animation in Japan: giant robots, spaceships, apocalyptic occurrences, over-sexualized girls, and it does so, I think, without criticizing these productions. And the people who made this film went on to established their own professional studio called Gainax in 1991, just at the beginning of the Heisei era. This studio produced a documentary called Otaku no Video, which also celebrates the otaku lifestyle. But as the Heisei era progressed, the otaku lifestyle began coming under heavy criticism in Japan. It became associated with acts of criminal violence. Dr. McDonald have spoken about it in her lecture, and this was actually there was a strong response to the connection between otaku and violence from Japan's artistic community, its pop artists. But the commercial animation community also started responding to this new negative image of the otaku. A prime example, and I realize some people will agree with me about this show being critical of the otaku lifestyle, given that the otaku are the people who made this show a huge hit, but Neon Genesis Evangelion, which premiered in 1995, let's take a look at what happens in this show. We have a story, the ultimate otaku fantasy. There's a boy who goes piloting a giant robot to fight monstrous creatures. He's surrounded by over-sexualized girls. But on the other hand, this boy is a complete loser. He lives a miserable life. He's isolated. That's a common criticism against the otaku. He's socially isolated. He can't form normal relationship with other people. He's not even very good at the job of fighting those monstrous creatures. And the beautiful women who surround him always look down on him. That's the otaku life of the early Heisei period, according to Gainax, the very same people who did the Daikon film a decade earlier. However, as we move to the 21st century, I think we can speak less of being critical toward the otaku lifestyle and more in terms of a post-otaku era, in the sense that there's a recognition of the tropes of otaku productions, even a positive one, alongside, I think, a message that there's something beyond, there's something more to life than these tropes. And my favorite example being Voices of a Distant Star, which, much like the Daikon films two decades earlier, Voices of a Distant Star released in 2002 was also an independent production. Director Makoto Shinkai animated almost completely on his own, animated this film on his home computer, and it is also a very large homage. It's a short film, but it's a very large homage to many of the tropes of the otaku favorite productions. We have a girl piloting a giant robot, going to space to fight aliens, but this girl also keeps in touch with her boyfriend on Earth using text messages on her cell phone. And Nisim, how much longer do we have?
7 minutes.
Ah, so I'm going to show a short scene from Voices of a Distant Star. And giant robots, and he animates them and designs them very handsomely. It's hard to believe that this film was done by a single person. But at the same time, he tells his audience that, yes, these things are nice, but there's more to life than that. It's not as important as keeping in touch with your loved ones, and don't go too deep into space, what literally happens in the film, so that you lose that touch with other people. And in Your Name, the film which Dr. Kameda Madar spoke of, Shinkai let go of the otaku tropes, but the message is pretty much the same, although this time with an optimistic conclusion. It is the simple connection between people that will save us from the apocalypse, Shinkai tells his audience in this film, which I think is a wonderful message to conclude the Heisei period with. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Raz, and actually some of the issues, especially otaku, I think resonates in both papers, and we'll discuss it later. I'm sure that we have a lot of things to say. But I would like to present our next presenters, Nitono Hiroshi and Shiri Liber Milo. So I will introduce them briefly. Hiroshi Nitono received his PhD in Human Sciences from Osaka University in 1998. From 2005 to 2016, he was an Associate Professor of Cognitive Psychophysiology at Hiroshima University. In April 2016, he moved to the Graduate School of Human Science, Osaka University, as full professor of experimental psychology. Although his main research field is psychophysiology and engineering psychology, he is exploring the psychology of kawaii and cuteness for several years. Shiri Liber Milo received her master's degree in Asian Studies, Japanese Culture Cluster from Tel Aviv University in 2013. After receiving a Japanese government scholarship of Monbu Kagakusho, she moved to Japan, to Kyoto specifically, to continue her research on Japanese culture. Currently, Mrs. Liber Milo is the third year PhD candidate at the Graduate School of Language and Culture, Japanese Culture Cluster at Osaka University, Japan. She is expecting to receive her degree in September 2017, which I'm sure will be very successful. Her ongoing research explores the cultural power of kawaii in and outside Japan. Onegaishimasu.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Do I need to use, can you hear me at the end? Do I need to use a microphone?
Yes.
So yes, I need to use a microphone. Okay. Thank you so much for the nice introduction. Okay, so I need to use a microphone. Okay. So thank you so much, and sorry for keep you waiting. And so my name is Shuri Libre, and me and Itono Asensi will talk today about the Korean cute aesthetic in contemporary Japan. So in this joint lecture, before discussing of course the kawaii and cute aesthetic in contemporary Japan, I really want to discuss what is actually kawaii. And this is actually a really interesting question, because many people, especially non-Japanese people, asking me what is the meaning of kawaii. Because when I'm explaining directly, if I will explain the meaning of kawaii, it will be a quite complicated one. Because in the direct English and even Hebrew, it's meaning cute. So cute in English and even pity. And in Hebrew, it's chamud and chamuda. But unlike the direct translation, kawaii actually consume within so many meanings. So many meanings, so from cute to beautiful. So it can actually be seen as kind of dissimilar between them. So actually in a survey that I conducted, maybe I can realize this, in a survey that I actually created and I distributed to 692 women at the age range of 18 and to 29 in Kansai region, I actually asked them how you defined kawaii. So it was really interesting how many words I actually got. So instead of cute or just saying cute or pity, actually, as you can see, they gave me so many answers. And of course, to organize the open-ended question, I actually created an affinity table, which I took the major words from the actually answers and actually created affinity table. And here you actually can see how they defined kawaii. So many words. So what is actually kawaii? How we define kawaii? So actually something cute and in terms of size, something really small, like animals, children, and if you can look, positive. Well, many of non-Japanese researchers believe that kawaii is actually infantile and childish, and really believe it's actually negative. The majority of the Japanese women, out of 460 filming response, the 216 gave positive characteristics such as lovely, charming, cute, innocent, nature, gentle. Of course, it's a direct English translation, because the answers were in Japanese. And only 63 women said something negative. So, well, of course, negative characteristics are actually existing in kawaii, which should actually look kind of infantile and pity. Actually, the majority, as you can see, said it's something, it's really positive one. But of course, now we actually talked about the kawaii as a word, as actually a noun, but it's also an adjective. Professor Nitono will actually speak about it as an adjective, but actually as a trend, the kawaii as the oval part, as a Japanese oval word was actually part of the Japanese culture for so many years, as a trend. It began with shoujo young women. Shoujo, it's meaning young women in Japanese, who actually shaped the kawaii and actually brought it to its current success. So thanks to the success of the shoujo subculture, the kawaii aesthetic have been flourishing the 70s. And today, it actually can be seen not only as a word, but also in a design. So I will talk about that in a few minutes. And also as a design in idols, in television and magazine, it's everywhere. So I done it quite fast. So this is the end of the first part of the joint lecture. Now Dr. Nitono, Professor of Experimental Psychology and Osaka University, will talk about the basic of the psychology of kawaii. And then I will back and introduce the current usage of kawaii in the Japanese industry.
Thank you, Tsuji-san. I'm Hiroshi Nitono from Osaka University. Today I'm talking about some basics of kawaii from a psychologist point of view.
Okay.
So, as Tsuji-san has already told, kawaii is a symbol of contemporary Japan. You know Hello Kitty? She's now 42 years old, born in 1974 and still active. More than 50,000 items are sold around the world. The light panel shows a screenshot of the website of the Japanese government. The Ministry of Foreign Affairs of Japan commissioned 3 kawaii ambassadors in 2009 and 10. They asked 3 young female fashion leaders to propagate Japanese pop culture to the world. The kawaii culture started as a subculture of Japanese schoolgirls in the 1970s, but it now becomes a mainstream. So, in January last year, the Wall Street Journal featured a new kawaii character. Character that may go beyond Hello Kitty. Do you know what it is? It is called Gudetama. Gudetama meaning a lazy egg yolk. The article wrote that this odd character is now accepted not only in Japan but also in Asia and other countries. I was so surprised to hear that this odd character is accepted outside Japan. So let's start with the dictionary meaning of kawaii. Kawaii is an adjective, like cute, but I also use it as a noun, like cuteness. The first meaning of kawaii is looks miserable and raises sympathy, pitiable, pathetic, piteous. That sounds strange for us. It's not cute at all. The second meaning is attractive, cannot be neglected, cherished, beloved, getting closer. Third meaning is has a sweet nature, lovely, adorable, attractive, and so on. This is kawaii in the current sense. So as you can see in this slide, kawaii has multiple meanings. Why? That is because the meaning of the word has changed over time. In ancient times, the word utsukushi has been used to mean sweet and lovely instead of kawaii. But the word utsukushi came to mean beautiful in modern times. Kawaii is a variant of kawaiui, which was originated from kawahayushi. Kawa means face. Hayushi means flashing or being illuminated. So this is the first meaning of kawaii, feeling ashamed of myself for someone look miserable. So in this slide, I would like to stress that kawaii is originally an affective adjective that express one's feeling toward some people or something. So I'll show you some example. The psychology of cuteness is usually connected to the concept of kinhenshima, baby schema. More than 70 years ago, Konrad Lorenz, an ethologist, proposed a set of physical features that induce nurturance and protection behavior with others. These features include a large head relative to body size, a high-end protruding forehead, and large eyes below the horizontal midline of the skull, and so on. Lorenz stated that these stimuli elicit a feeling that can be described as cute, sweet, and lovely. Interestingly, the idea was originally based on only Lorenz's personal introspection. However, subsequent empirical studies have shown that these features do elicit such a feeling. But kawaii in Japanese is not limited to babyishness or infantility. I made a survey to examine the relationship between kawaii and infantility. I asked Japanese university students to rate 93 items, either words or short phrases, that are sometimes described as kawaii. The items include flower, child, hamster, dog, heart, and so on. And we asked half of the university students to rate these items on the degree of kawaii, and the other half of, asked the other half of participant to rate on these items on the degree of infantility. So these are here are the result, the mean scores of the data for male and female students. Each circle corresponds to each item of the 93 items. And the upper position means more kawaii, and right positions means more infantile than left position. As you can see, there is a positive correlation, more infantile, more kawaii, positive correlation between kawaii and infantile, but not so strict. It's a moderate positive correlation. By the way, what do you think is the most kawaii things among these 93 items? Baby, kitten, or puppy? No, smile. It's very interesting, but smile has the latest, the highest kawaii ratings, both for male and females. So as you can see, there is a smile. High in kawaii but low in infantility. Baby is high in infantility and also high in kawaii. But as you can see in this slide, kawaii is not directly related to infantility. As a matter of fact, even an old man can give us an impression of kawaii when he smiles, right? So this is a model I proposed recently. Kawaii is not an attribute of an object. It's an emotion after cognitive appraisal. So I think kawaii is more emotion-centered concept than cuteness. What I would like to stress in this slide is that if we think kawaii, if we regard kawaii as an emotion, it's not just a personal feeling. It should have some objective manifestations. That means kawaii can change our behavior. So this is a model of cuteness response proposed by American researchers Sherman and Hyde 2011. They proposed that when we see something cute, we tend to have a goal of engaging with the entity socially. And this social engagement goal augments mentalizing. Mentalizing is a mental function to assume the others also have minds and try to understand what they think, desire, want, and intent. And also the social engagement goal facilitate affective, tender behavioral disposition. In the end, the people people include the entity which has a kawaii features in their own social group, moral circle, Sherman and Hyde called it. So I'll show you only one interesting example. It's a field experiment conducted at the coffee shops in South Korea. The researcher put donation box at coffee shops. There are two types of donation box, one with human-like character and the other without a human-like character. The results showed that people make more donation more frequently and a larger amount of money to the box with human-like characters. I think it's not a study about the effect of cuteness, but I think it's a kind of example that cuteness can make our can change our behavior. So in the later part, Silly-san will talk about the current usage of kawaii things to influence people in Japan. Okay, so please continue your lecture, Silly-san.
Thank you so much, Dr. Nitono. So I was just being told that I have 5 minutes, so I'll try to do it quick. So as we saw before, as Nitono-sensei actually said in the previous, cute things and kawaii things, actually that combines within pitfulness and cuteness, actually bring to affirmative feelings. Right, of one faces, large eyes, and petite body, actually brings to actually a good connection between the observer and the observed object. That is the reason recently, especially from the 70s, thanks to the shoujo culture, the kawaii aesthetic actually became a central tactic in marketing strategy. As we can see, if you've been in Japan, mostly been already in Japan, government offices such as police, and brought kawaii things to become, to promote civilian cooperation. As an example, you know, unlike Israel, you know, when there are signs, do not enter, or no, it's actually quite a frightening, right? There is a skull, but in Japan, unlike in any other country, if you see cute, these kind of cute characters, it's supposed to bring good communication between the observer and the observed object. Like this one, right? They got actually more donation when it was actually had a face on it. So it's exactly like this. So this is actually a representative of police. And you can see this actually a bunai, like don't enter. So instead of like in any other country, in Japan, when you see this kind of signs, you actually feel more connected to the observed object. So you will be more cooperative. So actually, kawaii also promote tourists. So in every city, these actually cute characters that actually is supposed to bring tourists. There's also in Osaka, Osaka University, it's an alligator. Yeah, it's an alligator cute university. Do you remember? So each university and each city, they have their own. This is part of Kyoto. So it's to promote people. But not only, as I said, Japanese government office, but also I really want to give a really interesting example about Israel embassy. In order to bring more Japanese to Israel and to bring also to more understanding, the Israel embassy in 2013 actually brought this character to life, which is named Shalom-chan. Probably you heard about this character. So they took actually the iconic Israeli dove, and in order to bring it to more kawaii, they actually changed it and utilized it to Shalom-chan. And of course, if you're looking at the before and after, the before one, it's look much mature, and they use in order to bring it to, you know, to adapt it to the Japanese visual eye, they use the kawaii aesthetic of cuteness of small, petite. You see the rounds, they created also body parts, and of course the symbolize of the Star of David and the olive, in order that it will have direct connection. And when I've been actually, and we've been together, remember in the Israel embassy in Tokyo, it's actually brought more people to be interested in Israel. And this is Shalom-chan. And they actually have an anime about Shalom-chan, and that you can understand. So yes, they're using the kawaii aesthetic as a tool to bring more people to understand Japan. So, for conclusion, because I have, I think, 2 minutes, for conclusion, actually, the current lecture shows that more than just awards, the trend of kawaii is a dominating accent in contemporary Japanese society and a useful tool for encouraging people to cooperate with the laws and regulation, as we saw before, transmitting a certain kind of sincerity and softness, and even innocent, and bringing to emotional closeness, as we saw, oh, he's so cute, right? The Shalomu-chan. And closeness and relationship between the observer and the observed object, and attracting consumers to purchase and follow cooperation, suggesting products and recommendation. I think it was 3 minutes, right, or 4 minutes. Thank you so much for listening.
Actually, perhaps if you can come to the first, yeah, you can come to the first row. Okay. So,
thank you so much for this. I think we had a very interesting panel and. Try to think about something. So I would like to just offer a few, thank you, just a few concluding words, and then we'll open the floor for discussion. So I think we had, maybe I'll talk about methodological issues. We had three different methodologies looking at anime, animation, and related issues such as kawaii. So Kaveda Madar's paper, I think she showed your talent with a very, I would say, deep and close reading of the anime text within the wider social context of the post-bubble generation. How did you call it? Bubble Jenna? What was the term? Lost Gene, okay, Lost Gene, yeah, I like this one, Lost Gene, right? Lost Gene, Lost Generation, okay, within the context of Lost Gene. Raz Greenberg, I think you had an interesting comparative approach of two different visions, which are otaku-based anime productions, and actually you look at the two different visions in the film you show, so in this sense, this comparative approach can give us new ideas about how visions, and you also talked about the production mechanism, how otaku is being integrated into the production of anime, and not only as consumers. And the final collaborative paper of Nitono and Shiri, I think what you did is very impressive because you offered empirical and I would say epistemological investigation into the sense of how media is being received. And this is the most hardest part because you can talk about the production part, you can analyze the text, but how it is being consumed, how it is being received, there is not so much information. And I think methodologically this is very important because you show it empirically that how it is being received, and this is something really new. So I was very happy to see different this part. Some issues, and I think that or that resonates in the three papers. The one is actually the role of otaku, right? And otaku, for those who doesn't know, otaku used to be regarded as the most avid consumers of popular culture, and their image and even status changed over the time from being like geeks, and actually today otaku is considered, you know, would be more socially acceptable. Even sometimes it's a bit of cool, if I may say. So actually otaku are very important, both as consumers, because they consume a lot of this popular culture productions, but also as producers, as Raz showed in his papers, you know, this is otaku-based production, but also as mediators, I would say, mediators between the established industries and the overall general consumers. A second issue is the mixed media. Mixed media is a term which developed from Japanese, from Japanese popular culture, which talks about how different media and entertainment stages are being integrated into this mechanism. So when you talk about anime, like you showed in your paper, you cannot talk about anime without talking about games, without knowing games, without fashion, without manga. So this kind of synergy between different media and entertainment forms came out I think in the three papers. And last thing is the notion of fandom. What is it to be a fan? And to be a fan is not only to consume or look, but fandom carries with it a lot of responsibility, a lot of action, I would say, a very active fandom. For example, you talked about fandom as being a pilgrimage and fandom, right? So a way to be a fan is actually to go on a pilgrimage-like journey to the world of animation. And I think that fandoms are, in this sense, not only fans, not only receivers of animation and of popular culture, but actually creating alternative worlds, if I may say. So I would like now to open the floor, and we'll take a few questions and comments, and then each of the presenters will have time to respond. Okay? Yes.
So we'll start over here. Yeah. And then
Can you please also introduce yourself?